So good morning, good evening, good afternoon, and welcome to Ask the Doc. I am Malin Regat, and I'm an occupational therapist from Stockholm, Sweden. And we will start with a presentation, and then there will be opportunities for you to ask questions. So please post them in the Q&A. And I will share my screen. So I am, as I said, an occupational therapist, and in contrast to a physical therapist that's usually more interested in a different type of exercise, I'm an occupational therapist focusing on helping people to manage their daily activities. And I will tell you a little bit about what I do in my profession and in my work in my societies. So let's see how I will. There you go. So today's session I will talk about different strategies on how to be smarter, energy preserving strategies. And I will also talk a little bit about hand function and hand exercise in myositis. And that is the only exercise I do as an occupational therapist. And I have done a few studies about that, so that's why. So I would like to start first by saying where I am. So I am in the little red dot, Sweden, when compared to the US. I work at Karolinska University Hospital, to the right in the picture, a new expensive hospital that they built a few years ago. I am also affiliated to Karolinska Institutet, where I do my research. And I live in the little island in the bottom of the map called Ekerö, which is Oak Island, you can say. A little bit outside of Stockholm. So I guess maybe a few of you have met occupational therapists, and this might not be any new information for you, but so the purpose of occupational therapy is to enable daily activities. And what we mean by daily activities is all the things you do during a day, from getting up in the morning and until you go to bed, and actually also sleep. So even during the night, it's a type of activities. As the profession, we usually divide activities into personal activities, which is more of the basic activities that we need to do, like eat, shower, get in and out of bed, and sleep. But also instrumental activities such as household activities, work, spare time, and also, of course, exercise, because we know it's important to do. So we talk sometimes about the occupational gap, which is the gap between what a person wants and needs to do and what they actually do. Occupational therapy, we often talk about also meaningful activities, because we believe that if you have a meaningful, if you fill your day with at least a few of those meaningful activities, it also improves your health and well-being. So there are different things that it can influence how you can perform your daily activities. In myositis, of course, the symptoms that myositis might cause could influence how you can perform your activities. It could be the physical function that is affected by muscle weakness. You might have reduced muscle endurance, and also the function of your hands, because they're kind of the tools we use doing activities. But also fatigue, which is tiredness that don't go away when you sleep, and also that we have recently pain, that is also quite a problem in myositis in some people. So those are the physical things that might constitute a problem to manage your daily activities, but it could also be other things like the environment at your home, the workplace, and the surroundings. So if you live in an apartment on the third floor without an elevator, it's probably a bigger problem than if you would live on the ground floor, if you have problems with muscle weakness in your legs, for instance. Also, what kind of personality you have, if you're a positive person or if you're not, if you're outgoing or if you're social or if you're not, with what kind of habits you have and interests. And we know that habits are really difficult to change. For me, like weight loss, it's very easy to go back and don't do exercise and eat the things that I shouldn't do. But we know how to do it, but the habits are strong. Also different kind of roles. It could be that you are a mother or a wife or a husband or a daughter or a co-worker or a friend. Within those roles, you might have maybe expectation from others, but also expectations from yourself, what you're supposed to do as this person. And might be that you don't have the energy to do it or to be that you used to be. For instance, it's very important for you to have a clean house, and if you can't manage, for me, I wouldn't mind because I don't like cleaning, but if you're a person that thinks it's important and it's part of your roles, it would affect you more in your well-being if you can't perform it, or if you don't have the finances that you can have others clean, for instance. Also, if you have close relationships like family and friends that support you, and also your physical status versus your psychological status also affects how participation can be affected in daily activities. As occupational therapists, we often talk about occupational balance, which means that you should have a balance between activity and rest. And many think that this battery that's on the slide from when you fully charge and you lose the energy, so you want to prevent to come to the red, because then it's kind of too late. You need to recharge before, so you don't go down, so you don't have enough energy at all. So it's important to have actively rest during the day, so the energy will be enough for different things that you want to do, and especially in those with fatigue. And as I mentioned before, that it should be the activities that we need to do, but also activities that are meaningful, because that could also give us energy. So it's a balance, and I understand, of course, that it's not easy to know. You have to learn and listen to your body and mind, what you can manage. Plan ahead. So if you know that you're going to do something energy demanding activities tomorrow, maybe you should do less today, and maybe don't plan for so much for the day after tomorrow, because you need to get the energy back. I met a person that really liked to do square dance, and it chose to do that even though it has to rest for at least one day after, because it was giving this person so much energy, even though the physical energy exhausted it totally. It could also be that you are conscious on how you perform activities. So if you can make it easier, if you can use maybe both hands by lifting heavy things, or maybe not have so much heavy things to lift, or have things close so that you can reduce the energy taking parts of your activities. So the best thing that we usually use is like a diary where you write what you do and how you feel afterwards and maybe how much energy it has taken. So then you can both look at what you do, but also the amount of the day that you do, so you can plan your days better for the next time. Good. So this is only an example of these things that could be part of your day. And you need to time manage your activities so you have enough energy for the things that you want to do. Good. So I will go further with a hand function that I said I would talk about a little bit. So I have done two studies, one with polymyositis and dermatomyositis, and one with inclusion body myositis. So that's kind of the reason why I mentioned these diagnoses, even though there are several other subgroups now. So if you look at the hand function in inclusion body myositis, we know that the finger flexors, or the muscles in the fingers that flex the fingers, are weak, which can lead to reduced ability to move the fingers, because they can kind of get stiff in their joints, but it's not the joints, it's the muscle that's reduced the ability to move the fingers. And also the ability to do fine motor skills like dexterity. And we did a study and we could see that women had approximately 42% and men 30% of what is normal in age and gender matched controls. And we could also see that the reduced grip strength was associated to daily activities and quality of life, and we used questionnaires to ask about that. For polymyositis or dermatomyositis, we have seen that the grip strength is reduced, which was not really said in the literature before, but they said that it could be present in the late phase of the disease. But we could see that it was reduced already in the beginning of the disease. And of course, if you have arthritis, which is also common in myositis, you would have problems with your hands because of the arthritis or the joint swelling or the inflammation in your joint. We did kind of the same type of study for poly and dermatomyositis, and there we could see that the women had approximately 71% and the men 60% of gender and age matched controls. So it seems, which is not surprisingly, that the IBM are more effective in their grip strength. For poly and dermatomyositis, we could also see that the grip strength were associated to domestic activities and quality of life. So I would say that it's important to do both mobility exercise for your hands and also strengthening exercise. In inclusion body myositis, as I mentioned before, the limitation in the joint mobility may occur due to the muscle weakness. So if you can't flex your fingers, the joints will get stiff because you haven't moved them. So it's in IBM important to both passively, which means that you help with the other hand, to flex the fingers and do the mobility program. I will show you a few slides with examples. And also do strengthening exercise once a day. Once a day, I have written it wrong. It's supposed to be with a C, sorry. So in polymyositis, dermatomyositis, we have not seen so much limitation in the joints, but it's important to check so you know when your fingers stop working, so you can do something about it. Because I think we are smart enough to avoid doing things that are difficult for us. That would mean, so if I can't flex my fingers, I would probably use my thumb a little bit, and then I won't get the mobility exercise that I might need, or maybe don't mention or see it until it's until it's a problem. So for poly and dermatomyositis, I would say do the exercise once a week and the strengthening exercise once a day. So these are a few, these are examples on what you can do. There are, of course, a lot of different things you can do with your hand to exercise it, but I think, and also what I've learned from the studies that we made, that it's better to maybe limit the amount of exercises that you do, so you will have energy for all the other things that you want to do. So minimize them, but still be enough and useful for you. So the first is the wrist, which is also good to exercise. The other one is where you flex the fingers in different ways so that you are sure that you are exercising all the joints and all the muscles of your hand. So maybe 5 to 10 repetitions per exercise. The reason why we split up the flexion of your fingers is because you're not allowed to cheat, because it's easy to do if you just flex the fingers. So that's why we have split it up in those first joints, and the joints, middle joint and the knuckles, and then in the end just flex, work to make a twist. Also the thumb, do round circles with your thumb towards your index fingers, but you could also do with the other fingers. And also move the thumb to see that you have the range of motion that the thumb can do. When using, when doing strengthening exercise, you should use, you can choose a ball or a dough. That gives enough resistance. So if you do the program that I will send afterwards, it should be so much exertion. So it's about 4 or 5 on this Borg scale. So it's important that it's heavy enough so you will increase your strength. But then again, it's important that you're able to flex the fingers or the thumb into the dough, so it's not too hard, so you would only be moving the outer joints. To have a ball that you still can squeeze, or a dough, and when it's when it might be too hard for you, it's easy that you press, and then it's easy that you will make your joints go backwards, which you don't want to. So then it's better to take a less the hard resistance ball or dough. So this is just squeezing a ball. You use the whole hand. The next one is supposed to, with the ball or the dough in between, you make the little circles that you did before, but you have that dough in between. Then you will get more exercise. And we are stronger in those three fingers, I don't know, index, middle finger, and the thumb. So these are the ones that we are mostly using also in daily activities, but these are also the ones that we are stronger. Using the ring finger or the, I don't know, we call it little finger in Swedish, but you know, the one in the end. Here we are really weak, which is normal. The thumb, which you put the dough in between your index finger and the thumb, so you will get kind of the key grip, the thing grip you get when you're holding a key, a usual grip that we use in activities. The fourth picture is that you press Index finger and middle finger towards the thumb, which is also a common grip that we use in it. And the last one is that you press the thumb towards your little finger, but you have the dough in between, so you'll get the exercise for the thumb. So that concludes my presentations, and I see that there are a few questions. I will stop sharing. Let's see. So I don't know if you want to, I won't say who said what, but I don't know if you have like the rules for privacy.
Yes, I'm sorry. Don't announce who is asking
I will
the
not
question.
Say who said it. Yeah. No. So
thank you.
So the question is, what questions should I ask my occupational therapist when first starting a program? So if that's the, if it's a program for occupational therapy, I would hope that they would ask you questions on how you manage your daily activities, which is kind of the purpose. Or if it's the hand exercise, because I see the next question is, does my OT have to know about my situs in order to develop a good program? It might be of the hand exercise. So I think, I mean, you can send her to this session and see it because it's recorded. And I think also I have, we have program at the TMA website. So I guess in rheumatology, if the occupational therapist is in rheumatology, they would probably know about the arthritis, RA, or rheumatoid arthritis, or other joints inflammation diseases. And in those cases, we have now seen that it's kind of okay to also put on some resistance to the exercise. So they might not be scared to increase. But as long as it doesn't hurt more than 2 hours you have done your strengthening exercise, it's good to go. So the question is, does the OT need to know about myositis? Well, it helps, but she can or he could always contact me. I can give them some advice. So, and the next question was, what can I do aside from therapy to maintain or gain function? And I remember I heard a presentation and they said that the best exercise that you can do to improve a certain activity is to do the specific activity that you want to improve. So everything you do during your daily activities is, of course, exercise as well. So you have to remember that it's not only this exercise or the exercise you get from your physical therapist, but it's also the thing that you do. So try to continue doing the things that you like and that you want to be able to continue performing. It could be that you need an assistive device or a technical device to make it easier, so you can still continue doing it, but then again it's better so you can continue. So what are alternatives to OT? I don't think really I understand what that question is. So if there's something else than OT that can help you, or is it something else? What do you mean? I think that what we're kind of good in rheumatology and also maybe neurology is that we work in teams. to improve the care for the patients. So we have, of course, the physicians that know all the things about the disease and the medications, and we have the nurse that helps us manage, and OTs and PTs, and I think also social workers can help, or a psychologist can help. Sometimes it could also be the, speech therapist if you have problem swallowing. So I think depending on what the problem is, and also have the team around you, it's good, because then you can get help from, I think maybe we kind of have the same goal to have good health and quality of life, but we have different ways to not attack, that's not the right word, but try to fix it. They ask if we can get a copy of recommendations, and that you can absolutely get, I assume, Rachel. Reading recommendations. Good questions. I can see and maybe add that. How will OT get me back to my everyday life? I guess so I think it's you. I think it's mostly you as a person, but they can help you with strategies and maybe technical aids, and help yourself, like self-management perspective. And also, what kind of equipment can be helpful to help with activities of daily living, like cooking and cleaning? So I guess you need to go back to the regular ergonomics, if you have. Which is that you carry things close to your body, because if it's far away, it's getting more heavy for your body, and it's easier to carry things when close by. Use both hands. So instead of having a heavy pan, you can have like those, I don't know, teflon, we call it in Swedish. I don't know, those non-stick easy pans. Maybe sit down when you cut the vegetables. It could be that you don't clean all the house or all of the house, but maybe a room at a time and then rest. It could be maybe a cushion that you get easier up from the chair, or on from the toilet seat. You can have like a toilet razor. Well, you know, Swedish, it's called other things in Swedish. I'm sorry. It could be like a feature, is it called? Like a syringe where you can pick up things from the floor, but it could also help you put the trousers on if you have trouble bending down. So I got a question that I have bilateral parasthesias in my chins and dorsum of feet that worsens with activity. Would physical therapy help with this? This is a very specific question that I don't really know if I can answer. So I would suggest that you maybe talk to your physician, and also maybe the physical therapist. And what would be the best solution for you? Sometimes it could be that it's it could be like a threshold before you see the improvements, but it could also be that it's enough to do the activities that you do. So, and the next question is if I can recommend any swallowing exercise, and I cannot. I know that we have like face, but that is more if your muscles in your face is not so movable, but swallowing, no. So then I would suggest to talk to a speech therapist, which know these things better than I do. Good. And the next question is that I have, IBM. I find it difficult to do some hand exercises because of pain from my osteoarthritis, specifically pain at the base of my thumb. Any advice on how to perform these IBM exercises while avoiding worsening my osteoarthritis? I think it's quite important also to do hand exercise with osteoarthritis. So then I would actually add this movement for the thumb so that you would do like this, which is good for the osteoarthritis. Sorry. Other things that you could do if you have problems with pain in your hands, maybe not in the exercise situation, it could be some kind of splints that you can have on your hands to stabilize joints, or maybe also give support so that you would get more force and maybe less pain also afterwards. So in activities, splints could also help. Also, if you're weak in your hands, I have people that have those like wrist splints that give your hand this kind of position, and could help them while they're typing on their computer, so don't have to lift their hands doing it, which is kind of good. Gripper, is that the reach thing? Yeah, probably. Thank you. Let's see. It's helpful to use a handheld exercise strength grip, or is it harmful? So some kind of equipment that you use to exercise the hand? No. As long as, I think the rule of thumb is if you have pain more than 2 hours after you have been exercising, you have done it too much, so do less the next time. As long as you don't, as I said, as long as the joints don't go backwards like this, because then it's not good. So if you can still flex, I guess that's some kind of a thing that you hold in your hands with like spirals or something that you would, I guess that's some kind. So at least as long as you can flex the fingers so, and they don't go backwards and it's not just in the end like this, it's good. I don't think it's harmful. But you don't get so much exercise if you can't move more than this. But if you can flex the fingers good and don't over stretch the joints, it's okay. Do you always need to do 3 sets of 10 to make a strength difference? I don't think so. In the pictures that I made for you, it was like 10 to 15. Per exercise, and I didn't say 3 times. I hope I didn't say 3 times. So as long as you'd get enough exertion afterwards, I think it's okay. I think probably the physical therapist would say something else, but for the hands, I think it's enough. Could be that you also don't use as much strength as you do in, I don't know, the thighs when you're walking or when you're biking. Then you need to have the strength for a longer time than for the hands. You might need a lot of strength, maybe a few moments, but then it's more like an in-between maintenance strength that you need. I would say.
Okay, yeah. Is that all of them?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Dr. Rigart. We really appreciate you coming on today and sharing your expertise. And for those of you that wanted this as a resource, yes, we can get it to you. Email rachel@myositis.org. That's R-A-C-H-E-L @myositis.org. And I will get that to you. Thank you so much. Yeah, have a great day.
Thank you. Bye.